Welcome to the second week of the Powering Agriculture MOOC on Sustainable Energy for Food. Within that initiative, USAID, the governments of Sweden and Germany, as well as Duke Energy and OPIC, promote clean energy solutions in the agriculture and food sector. For the MOOC, the partners are cooperating with TH Köln, a university of applied science based in Cologne, Germany.
Hello and welcome back. Today we are in the second week of our course. The content for this week is structured in two different parts. In the first part, you will learn about the basics of renewable energy resources, their origin and linkage to the agro sector. In the second part, we will discuss different technologies to harness these resources and their applications in agro sector. We introduce these technologies very shortly here, but you can go through the recommended reading materials to learn more on specific resources and technologies of your interest. Okay, let's start now. Perhaps you already know we can divide energy resources into two major groups, renewables and non-renewables. Non-renewables are also called conventional resources. They have limited reserves and they will be depleted upon consumption. Examples are coal, oil, and natural gas. Today, these resources dominate our global energy economy in residential, industrial, and transportation sectors. Their combustion is mainly responsible for carbon dioxide emissions, and they pose also other environmental threats. In this lecture, we will not discuss these fossil fuel resources further, as there are better alternatives, which are renewable energy resources. Those resources are by definition perpetual, which means they do not deplete upon consumption. Also, they do not pose such environmental threats during their use, and they are available almost everywhere. Renewable energy resources have basically three origins: solar radiation, gravitational force of the planet, and thermal energy stored inside the earth. Geothermal energy is an example of energy stored inside the earth. Tidal energy in ocean is the result of planetary motion and gravity. Now, let's talk about the solar radiation. Solar radiation can be used directly, for example, solar photovoltaics or thermal systems, or indirectly. Wind, water, and biomass are only possible due to the sun, and thus they are indirect use of solar energy. Biomass energy is used by human since ancient times for cooking and heating. Traditionally, water mills are used in agro-processing activities in different countries. Common uses are grain grinding and oil extraction from oil seeds. Windmills are also traditionally used for water pumping in irrigation. The four most commonly used modern renewable energy technologies include hydropower plants, wind turbines, bioenergy, and solar PV and thermal systems. Let us take a look at the use of wind and water resources first. Hydropower and wind energy systems have similar working principle. They convert the kinetic energy of moving fluid into mechanical energy using a turbine. In hydropower plant, the moving fluid is water, and in wind turbine, it is air. The resulting mechanical energy at the rotating shaft can be used as such, or it can be converted into electricity using a generator. Electrical energy is the most versatile form of energy, as you know. Let's talk about hydropower in brief. According to their installed capacity, hydropower plants are broadly categorized as large, medium, and small hydropower. Large and medium-sized hydropower plants are connected to the transmission grid, and they act as central power plants, similar to fossil fuel power plants. Large and medium hydro plants have generally storage dams. However, small hydropower plants are mostly without dams. and they use river flow directly. Microhydropower plants are a common example. Their capacity range could be from a few kilowatts to some hundreds of kilowatts. Those plants are used in many rural areas of developing countries for rural electrification as well as for powering small agro-businesses. A microhydropower plant consists of different components. At the weir, the river flow is diverted into a channel. The channel leads the water to a four-way tank. At four-way tank, water enters into the penstock. It later hits the turbine blades and causes the turbine shaft to rotate. A generator connected to the rotating shaft produces electricity. Water leaving the turbine flows back to the river. All electromechanical components are housed in a building, which is the powerhouse of the hydropower plant. In order to estimate the power output of a hydropower plant, you need to know two site-specific parameters: quantity of the water or water flow rate and elevation difference of water inlet and outlet or the head. Additionally, you need two constants, gravity and water density. By multiplying these four parameters, you get the theoretical power output from water. If you further multiply this output with the efficiency of the system, you can obtain the real power output from the plant. You can further multiply this power output by the number of hours the plant is operating in a day or in a year to obtain the energy yield. Let's now move from hydropower to wind energy. According to the shaft orientation, wind turbines are classified into horizontal axis and vertical axis turbines. Horizontal ones are most commonly used. Today, for electricity generation, three-blade turbines are most common. Multiple-blade turbines are suitable for water pumping. On-site wind measurement is necessary to estimate the power output from the wind turbine. Power from wind is proportional to the power of 3 of the wind speed. Another parameter you need to know is swept area, which is the area covered by the blades while rotating. In the reader document, you find details on the real power output and energy output from a specific wind turbine for a specific site. The third energy resource we mentioned before is bioenergy. Bioenergy resources can be found in different forms, for example, wood, biofuels, and biogas. You will learn more on this topic during the third week. Now, let's talk about solar energy. We can divide solar energy into solar thermal and solar PV. In solar PV systems, the photon energy of incoming solar radiation strikes the solar cell. This energy excites the electrons from the cell, and they flow through the conductors attached to it. In this way, direct current electricity is generated. A PV module consists of many solar cells. As for needs, many modules can be connected together for higher power yield. Solar thermal systems work on a different principle. The radiant energy from the sun is converted to heat using solar collectors. Common uses are domestic water heaters or solar air heaters. If higher temperatures are desired for cooking or power generation, incoming solar radiation can be concentrated to a receiver. The power plants, based on this principle, are called concentrating solar power plants, or CSP in short. The energy output of a solar energy system depends mainly on the available solar radiation on site. Now, you will learn about two main solar energy applications. First, solar dryers. Have you seen the open sun drying of grains and vegetables? I guess so. Same can be done with solar dryers. Solar dryers are used by many farmers in many countries to avoid post-harvest losses. The working principle is very simple. freshly harvested fruits, vegetables, or even fish and meat are placed in a drying chamber. Sunlight heats up the absorber of the collector, and thereby air inside the chamber is heated. This hot air carries away the moisture content of the food. With solar dryer, the drying rate is faster, and the quality of the dried products is better than in open sun drying. The second application is solar PV irrigation system. In many places today, a diesel engine is used to power water pumps for irrigation. However, the use of diesel has many disadvantages, such as higher fuel costs, CO2 emissions, high maintenance cost, etc. A solar PV operated irrigation system can overcome these problems. Such systems usually consist of four main parts: a photovoltaic array to produce electricity, a control unit to monitor the system, a water pump to lift the water to a storage tank, and an irrigation system to distribute the water. You will learn more on this once you complete the assignment of this week. There, you will design your own PV irrigation system for the site of your choice. Now, we are almost at the end. I hope this course helps you to get a general overview on renewable energy and their use. You will find more details on each topic we have discussed here in the recommended literatures for further reading in the reader document. Thank you for your attention, and I wish you now a good luck with the quiz. See you again in my next lecture.
Thank you for your attention, and see you next week. Thank you.